Right then, as promised, we're going to take a look at the Ienumerable Interface. It's one of the most fundamental interfaces that we have in the whole of C# and .NET, and in fact it works alongside a similarly named but slightly different interface called Ienumerator. So we're going to be looking at both of those, see how they work. We looked at Ienumerable actually in my very first video when we were comparing it with iQueryable. We're not going to be looking at that level, we're looking at it more fundamentally this week, but certainly you might be of interest to look at that Ienumerable versus iQueryable video as well. But for now, let's take a look at this example. And what we've got here is just a simple list of ints, and then one of the most common fragments of code you'll ever see in C#, we've got a foreach loop. And we know that if we run that, then we'll simply get those ints printed out. But what I want to show you is, if for some reason we didn't have the foreach keyword in C#, how could we achieve the same thing? Now, obviously, there's lots of ways to do this. We could have written a while loop or anything like that, but this is going to be to exactly mimic what we have in the foreach loop. Because the first thing we're going to do, we're going to declare a variable of type Ienumerator. So this is that other interface I mentioned, and it's a generic again, so we're going to instantiate it for int, and we'll just call that en equals ints dot get enumerator. And so we can see on our collection, and in fact on every collection, this is in a sense the defining quality of a collection, it has this get enumerator. What do we then do with get enumerator? Well, we can say while, so we are going to use a while loop actually, en dot move next, and then we simply say console, right? So whatever the body was here, we're putting it in there, and we say en dot current. And let's just comment out that for now, but we'll see exactly the same behavior. So that, in fact, if we were to have a look in the intermediate language, you would see that whenever you write a foreach loop, you pretty much get something looking like that. So you get hold of the enumerator and then have this while loop. And just to explain what's going on there, it's pretty simple. Move next does two things. It moves you, obviously enough, onto the next element in the container, so from 3 to 56, from 56 to 78, but also it returns a bool to tell you whether we've reached the end. So when we've got as far as 22 and we say move next, it simply returns false, so we know to terminate the loop. And then current is obviously the current place we are, and you can see that here current is of type int because this was an enumerator of type int. So whatever your collection type, current is going to be the thing that we have there. And really, that's all there is to it. That is what makes the foreach loop work. And it's not a huge saving, but given this is such a common thing, it's easier to have the foreach loop as part of the language than to be writing that out every time. The thing is, of course, where does getEnumerator come from? Well, if we take a look at our list, we can see it implements, as we mentioned, Ienumerable. That's what makes it a collection that you can use in a foreach loop. And our Ienumerable, that's where the getEnumerator method comes from. So that's why we say that the defining quality of a collection that can be used in a foreach loop is it must implement Ienumerable. And that's done by all of the standard containers. But let's see, what if we were going to write our own container? So the other program I've got here, if we just set that as the startup project, I've got a simple collection. I've got the element in that collection is of type book, so we've just got a title, author, and a toString, and then we've got library, and a library is a collection of books. But it's not as yet a true collection because it doesn't implement Ienumerable. All I've put in there is a method to add a book, an indexer to get hold of a book at a particular position, and then a count that tells us how many books we've got. And the actual storage I've just done in an existing container, and this is almost always the case. Even when you write your own container, you don't write it from scratch, you wrap up one of the existing containers, in this case, just a list. So that's what we've got there. And then if we look in the program for this one, then you can see I've just created my library, created a few books, and then at the moment, I'm actually using a very old-fashioned way. I'm using a for loop to count through all of the elements. And so we see the four books there. The reason being, the foreach won't work because we haven't implemented Ienumerable, and so we're getting the error there, basically saying that it can't find the getEnumerator method. So that's what we want to do. We want to implement Ienumerable. And so if we go back to our library, simply enough, we're going to say colon Ienumerable, in this case, instantiated for book. So that's what we've got there. Let's pop in our implement interface. And if you saw the last video and was talking about explicit interface implementation, you'll be aware of this. But the fact is, when we do that, we actually have to have these two implementations for reasons of backwards compatibility. So generics only came into .NET in Visual Studio 2005. So that's the generic version, but we still have lurking there this non-generic version, which was what we had before. And we've got to implement both of those, but we'll see actually we can implement them in the same way. So it's not too much of an issue. But what we need to do then is we need to return an enumerator for book. And although this probably isn't the normal way you'd do it, I'm just going to show you how to do this entirely by hand for yourself so that we can see how that works. So what I will do is let's pop into here a new class, and I'm going to call this book enumerator. And we'll make it public. And this is going to implement that other interface, ienumerator. So our library was an ienumerable, and this is an ienumerator for book. And once again, let's do the implement interface. And here we'll see some things we find familiar, because there we've got the move next that we're just looking at over here. There's the move next. And then we've also got the current. And actually, we've got two currents, because ienumerator has the same problem that we've got the generic version, so the current is of type T, book in our case, and then also, for historic reasons, we've got the non-generic version where it's just an object, and so it could be anything at all and you'd have to cast it. So that's the only difference really between them. And so we've got to have both of those in there. And then also, we don't need it here, but we do have a dispose there, because this enumerator could be connecting to any kind of collection. It could, for example, be connecting to a collection stored in a file or stored in a database, in which case when you'd finished with it, you'd need to do something to dispose. So enumerator itself implements dispose, but in our case, because it's all in memory, we can just leave that as doing nothing, but it does have to be there. And in fact, what I'd missed out here is foreach would actually put all of this into a using block, so that the dispose would get called at the appropriate time, even though in this case it doesn't actually do anything. So we don't need anything in our dispose. What we do need to do though is we need to, in our enumerator, store a reference to the thing we're enumerating through, which in this case, remember, is going to be our library. So we will just have underscore library there. And we're also going to have to keep track of where we are in the library. All sorts of ways you can do that, but to keep it simple, we're just going to have an index, so we'll call that IDX for index. And then we'll have a constructor here which will take a library as the parameter, and also we'll initialize the index to -1. It's important to do that. It doesn't start at naught. Just notice again how it works. The very first thing you do is move next. So that's going to move you onto the zeroth element in the collection. So we've got to initialize it to being before the zeroth element. So that's why we have -1 in there. While we're doing that, also something we didn't use, but is sometimes useful, we have this reset, which basically just sets you back to the beginning. So here we're going to implement that as underscore IDX equals -1. So that will take us back to the start again. And then move next is going to say return, and then ++ IDX. So remember, the move next does two things. It moves us on, so that's ++ IDX. And then we've got to check that we haven't reached the end, so we return that that is less than library.count. And then finally, we just need to implement our current. So remember, we've got two of these. One is strongly typed, returning a book. So what I'm going to do there is simply return underscore library. Remember, library has an indexer, so we just put that in there. And then the other one is really simple, because it's doing exactly the same thing, just returning it as an object rather than returning it as a book. So we could put that straight in there and that would work fine. But actually, what I would normally do is simply return the other current. So that current is the book one, but because book is derived from object, then that's going to work fine. So now that's it. We have an enumerator for book. And all we've got to do is make sure now our library in its getEnumerator returns that. So here we've just got to say return new book enumerator and pass in ourself. Because remember, the book enumerator takes the library. And once again, on the other one, just implement it in terms of the first one. So the non-generic one, we can simply say return get enumerator. And because of the precedence rules regarding explicit interface implementation, that one is actually the generic version, so it's not recursive, it's going to call the correct thing. And having done all that, now if we go back to our program, we'll find that our foreach loop now works. So if I comment out that old-fashioned loop, we can now see that that works in exactly the same way. And so now we've implemented our Ienumerable and returned an enumerator for our library. Actually, though, that's probably more work than is necessary in the vast majority of cases. Writing your own enumerator would imply you'd written your own collection. Now, you could argue we have here, but we haven't really, because our library is just a way of wrapping up the list. And of course, the list already is a collection, therefore already has its own get enumerator. So in the majority of cases, actually, you don't need to write your own. You can simply here return books.getEnumerator. Okay, because that's an enumerator for books, and that's going to take us through the list. And so when we run the program, we'll get exactly the same behavior, but we managed it, in fact, without any of this code at all. So although that shows us how you might do it, and if you were writing library code, if you'd had to write the list class for yourself, then maybe that's what you'd be using. But as far as our code goes, that's now completely redundant because it's just using the one that's built in for the list generic. And so that's the more normal way you do it. You just hand out the enumerator from whatever collection you've got for your internal private storage. So up until Visual Studio 2008, that was really the purpose of the Ienumerable interface, to allow you to have collections that could use foreach loops. But what was introduced with 2008 was link, and with that, a large number of extension methods that actually extended the Ienumerable interface. And again, this was what we're discussing in that earlier video, the difference between the way Ienumerable and iQueryable were extended. But looking at Ienumerable, if we now go back to our program, we can see if we just include the link library, we will now have all of these extension methods. So I can do things like foreach var b in library dot skip one dot take two. So that will skip one and moves on to Emma, and then take two, it'll just give us back Emma and Goldfinger. And you can imagine that all of that can be achieved simply through the methods we've put on the enumerable and the enumerator. So to do a skip one, you just do a move next and you don't bother to print out the value. To do a take two, you just loop through twice and get the current. So it's quite simple to do. Some of the other ones are a bit more complicated, things like we can do a reverse on that, and that will give us Goldfinger Emma rather than Emma Goldfinger. But again, you could work out how to write that for yourself if it wasn't already there for you. Or we could do library.where b gives b.author.ends with Austin. So any book by anyone whose name ends in Austin. And we can see that. Or we can even do things like console write line and then library.max of b gives b.title. So by max of title, that's going to give us the one latest in alphabetical order. And so we get Pride and Prejudice. That's the last one in alphabetical order. One final thing to mention here is that although almost always we do this through Ienumerable, when it comes to that foreach loop, strictly speaking, that does not require library to implement the Ienumerable interface. All it requires is that library has a method called getEnumerator returning the appropriate type. So actually it's a compile time check against the method on the class, not against the interface itself. So I could actually go back to my library and not have that IEnumerable at all. I could also get rid of the non-generic implementation and simply have an appropriate getEnumerator. And we can see that the foreach loop is still perfectly happy for that. It's not insisting on the interface. And so in older code, you'll sometimes see people not bothering with the interface and just putting the getEnumerator straight in there. But the problem is the thing we lose, or the things we lose, are all of those extension methods, because the extension methods do extend the interface, not simply call the getEnumerator method. And so that will only work if we have those in there, and then that's back and working fine. One final thing, something we've been able to do with collections since Visual Studio 2008, so it came along with Link as well, is the ability to do collection initialization. So rather than what we're doing here, where we create the library and then we add the four books to it, we can change this code around a bit. We can put in a curly brace. We can get rid of those library.adds. We can replace on the end with just a comma. And then that will initialize the collection in exactly the same way, so we get the same results. But that works because of two things. One is our library class has to have the IEnumerable interface, but also it has to have an add method, because in fact, all that's happening here is it's still just adding the four books with a separate call to the add method. But in terms of laying out the code, it's much nicer to be able to make it look like initialization. And the interesting thing there is the add isn't actually part of any interface. It's just something that's checked by the compiler. So you've got to have the IEnumerable interface, plus you've got to just have this add method. So that was it. The two interfaces, IEnumerable and IEnumerator. Similar names, but doing slightly different parts of the job of allowing us to have foreach loops and also giving us those extension methods. Next time, we're going to move on to what I promised, which is covariance, and we're going to see how that's a very important feature with IEnumerable as well. But for now, hope you enjoyed that. Do subscribe, do ask any questions, and I'll see you next time.